most of the time, a lot of you have not even looked at the syllabus, right? But then, before we go, the syllabus has an appendix which tells you all the necessary things you need to understand. Now, before we even come into the syllabus, let's go into the appendix to know what the focus is, okay? So at the back of the syllabus, they give you all the tricks and techniques, but people do not even know. See, let's come here. You see, they are giving us technical knowledge, what we are supposed to know. When you see one, it means low priority, right? When you see two, it means medium priority area. And when you see three, it means what? Who can tell me what three means?
Higher priority.
High priority, meaning you should put your focus there. If you want to pass, this is your guide now. Your guide is not anywhere. And no one, right? So first of all, before we even dive deeper, these are the things that we must know and understand, right? So you see, we have two papers here, Principles of Tax, Advanced Taxation. Now, when you look at the Ghana tax system, that means what are taxes, the different kind of taxes, the characteristics of a good tax system, social attributes of taxation, you know, the economic attributes or objectives of taxation, those kind of stuff, right? Shiftability of taxes, indirect, direct taxes, ad valorem, special taxes, just knowing about the Ghanaian tax system, the general overview. Nobody needs it at the advanced level. So you see, it's blank. Nobody is going to ask you theory there. Do you get it? But you see, when you look at principles of taxation, what's the level of, what's the priority level there? What's the priority level there?
One.
Low priority, one. When we say low priority, doesn't mean it won't come. It can come, but the marks are not that heavy. You get it? So like 5 marks be maximum. Makes sense. Does that make sense to all of you? Does that make sense to all of you? Hello? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Now, okay, yeah. Go to fiscal policy. Now, fiscal policy. Now, for those, please, those doing principles of taxation, please show by hand. If you are doing principles of taxation, just show by hand. Everyone do principles of taxation. I want to give you a simple trick. Just show by hand. How many of you are doing principles of taxation? Yes, I've only seen one hand. Yes. Who else? I mean, it's all of you here, advanced people. No problem. Listo, you're welcome.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So now listen. You see, the Ghana tax system, fiscal policy, and tax administration, okay? Those are sure bankers that when you focus on, at least some 20 marks are guaranteed. These areas, questions will always be repeated no matter what you do. Do you get the idea? Questions will always be repeated no matter what you do. So from henceforth, if you are learning, just get the past questions and just focus on those areas, because there's no question I see hasn't asked on public debt before. There's no question you haven't asked on fiscal policy, right? Before we move, when we talk about fiscal policy, everybody here needs to understand fiscal policy. Fiscal policy is just how the government controls the economy through the use of public expenditure and taxation. So in simple terms, you are saying that, okay, if I want the economy to stabilize, then I must find a way to manipulate the economy, right? Using these tools, we call them fiscal tools. And the fiscal tools are public expenditure and taxation. So in actual sense, if we look at the economy, remember the economy can be a boom or it can be in recession. When the economy is at a boom, it means it has its peak, right? We are making so much money. Everybody is happy. Money is flowing in the system. So we say it is booming, right? And we could also have what? A recession. Right now, what happens is that when there's a boom in the economy, it means there's so much money in the hands of people. Okay, and if there's so much money in the hands of people, what should government do? Would government take money from people, or government will push more money into the system? Please answer that question for me. Let's make it interactive.
He will try to reduce the money flow in the system.
Yes, And how does he do that? By increasing what? Taxation. Do you get the idea? So increasing taxation would mean the government will take more money from the hands of people, right? So he increases taxation and reduces public expenditure. And anytime government reduces public expenditure, it means you, the individual, the little money that you have, you are going to incur that expenditure to support yourself instead of government providing that thing for you. You get the idea? So when that happens, that means if the economy is expanding, we want to contract it or reduce it. Right? So reducing the economy to make it stable. So we have boom, recession, and then we have a stable economy, which means that it is smooth, right? There's no up and down. And achieving a stable economy may be difficult, right? But you can gradually work towards it. So government must increase taxation and what? Reduce public expenditure. Now, how did government do this? Government does this with what? Its own discretion. So when we talk about fiscal policy, we have two main types of fiscal policies, right? Two main types. And the first type is what we call the discretionary fiscal policy, right? So you see, government used its own discretion, not so, to increase taxation and reduce public expenditure to actually control the economy, right? The second type of fiscal policy is what we call the automatic stabilizers, right? Or automatic fiscal policy. So you can talk about automatic stabilizer, right? Now, as part of the discretionary fiscal policy, we saw that the government was trying to what, contract or reduce the economy when the system was booming, right? This type of fiscal policy is what we call what, a contractionary fiscal policy, because you are trying to contract the economy, reduce it, right, to an acceptable level. So contractionary what, fiscal policy, which is still discretionary because government does it himself, okay? Now, what if the economy was in recession? Should government push more money into the system or government to take more money out? Should it do withdrawal or invest? It's just investment by the government. Yes?
Invest.
He should invest into the economy, right? To grow it. So when that happens, what should they do? He will increase what? Public expenditure and also.
And reduce taxation.
To bring money into the hands of people. Does that make sense? So when he does this, we say he is expanding the economy. So that is an expansionary fiscal policy. You see how easy this is? Yes, that is it. So the discretion, you see, all these things were at the discretion of government. So we call it discretionary fiscal policy. Makes sense. Now, then we come to the next type, which is the automatic stabilizers. You know, there are some things that when they change, some things change automatically. Do you all agree with me that if the dollar falls against the cedi, definitely inflation is going to reduce? True or false?
True.
True or false? Why? Did somebody control this? It happened. When one, you see, this thing stabilizes itself. It's automatic. When the dollar falls against automatically inflation starts falling. Why? Who can tell me why? Who can tell me why?
Sir, the question again, sir.
I said, if the dollar starts falling against the cedi, automatically inflation in Ghana will start reducing. Why is that so?
It increases the purchasing power.
Yes. Because now if I import, it's not going to cost so much. At the end of the day, the final price the consumer is going to pay is going to be lower. At the end of the day, general price increases of goods and services will be seen to be going down. So this is a type of automatic stabilizer. Another type is, when inflation reduces, you see that employment will start increasing. Why? You see, there are some things that when one variable changes, it automatically affects other variables in the economy. No interference of government. When that thing happens, automatically it stabilizes another part of the economy, right? We call that automatic stabilizer. You get it? You see, this one, government uses discretion to tweak taxation of public expenditure, right? But here, government didn't do anything. It stabilized on its own with some small effort or minimal effort of government. So literally, this is what you have to know. And you have to know the tools that we use for fiscal policy, right? And the tools are simply taxation. No, so you can use taxation. You can use what? Public expenditure. You can use the government budget. Okay. And government budget, you have to know the different types of budgets. No, so balanced budget, surplus budget, budget deficit, then public debt, right? So these are the, when government wants to incur public expenditure, sometimes he does not have enough money. He's supposed to go for public debt. When you know these things, you know this side. And this side, I think almost every day, there's questions coming from there. And this is literally a summary of all that. Are we okay? So that is for those doing principles of taxation. I hope it helped. I hope you won't forget this though. Is the summary good enough? Was the summary good enough?
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's fine. Now, when you look at this, you see, at principles of taxation level, everything is not everything is medium or low priority, but that doesn't mean you don't have to learn it, right? Medium priority means theory level or knowledge level. High priority means application level. So when you look at it, you see tax administration, you see it's not here at all. But people are like, oh, tax admin is not in advanced taxation. Don't lie to yourself. Why? You see, there's something here called client communications. How do clients communicate? This is known as communicating with clients and the tax authorities, which includes tax administration. For instance, if a client has to communicate with GRE, he does so through what? Returns. True or false? Through assessment. Through audits. Right? So client communication is still tax administration. Through objections. So anytime you are communicating, you communicate through these legal and administrative guidelines and administrative directives. So tax administration is very high at your level. Actually, the whole, everything you are doing, apart from the theory side, is examinable at the advanced taxation level. Now, but you see, ICA has been very fair to ICA students, such that indirect taxes are very high at our level, but it has never been examined because they want to focus more on the tax planning. I hope that's okay. Hello. I hope you are learning something.
Yes, sir.
Now, when you come to level two, okay, tax planning is there, all right, but we capture it as part of the Ghanaian tax system. Okay, everything we do in level three is still in level two, but on the surface. You get the idea. So these things, I want you to keep them in mind. So what are the things that the advanced level we are concerned about? Income taxes. When we talk about income tax, we are talking about the basis of income tax, knowing chargeable income, knowing assessable income, knowing business income, investment income, employment income. You just have to know what they all entail, knowing allowable deductions, right? Everything about income tax, you have to be a master. Even at level two, you still have to have some particular knowledge, right? To be able to at least compute tax liabilities on the basic level. Then you come to taxation of companies. So this income tax will include the taxation of individuals and then partnerships, right? Okay, these are the areas that you have to know and understand. Are you getting it? Even at the advanced level. Then when it comes to corporate tax, you are looking at taxing companies, right? Taxing companies. But at level two, when you are taxing companies, you are only focusing on them. At level two, when you are taxing companies, the focus is more on merchandise entities, okay? So merchandise entities like companies who sell or manufacture, right? But at level three, it may be possible they may tweak in other type of entities, okay? So when you look in the law, actually under section 130, section 130, for me, I like to be very practical. I use the law all the time. I believe that's the main source. That's the main source of knowledge for your tax exam. So I always use that as a key requirement. Don't worry. Just exercise patience. Today you learn so many things. It's patience and consistency wins all wars. So let's see. Now, as I was saying, when you look at it, right, we have so many different entities, but at level two, the focus is just on the merchandise entities. Now, let's look at the definition of company under section 133. Right? company, C, right? So let's see the definition of company. I want one person to read for me. Company, 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 company. Please read for me. What does it say? Who read for me? Company. Please quickly. We have
it. Quickly. We have it.
So company means a company incorporated under the law of government, law of Ghana or elsewhere, and includes A, friendly society, building society, or simple society.
Similar society.
Similar society.
B, pension fund, provident fund, retirement fund, supernuity fund, or simple fund. C, government, a political subdivision of government, or government or public international organization, but does not include partnership or trust.
That is it.
That is it.
When we say corporate taxation, it inculcates all these things inside. At level two, most of the time, they normally look at merchandise entities, right? Entities which just deal in selling, you know, those that have cost of sales, okay? But when it comes to level three, the focus is not on just those type of companies. You could have a liability for a company which is still dealing in merchandise or mercantile system, okay? Merchandise. Two, you can have a company which is an exempt entity. So when we say exempt entity, we mean that it could be what? A charity, it could be a friendly society, building society, and also a retirement fund. These things mostly are exempt from tax, right? But provided that you apply to the Commissioner General, you have some rules you need to follow, okay? Apart from this, you have what? Government-related entities, right? But most of the time, the law does not go there because most of them are not going to pay taxes because most of them raise their own IGF, okay? So that one, you did it in public sector. So nobody really worries himself to give you government-related entities. But then, you can get petroleum companies, so petroleum-related businesses, or mining businesses, okay? So to some extent, they could even go into the financial sector, insurance and banking, right? Our time, we used to do insurance and banking, but it has never been examined in this new syllabus. Though it should be there, it's part of the specialized industries. Okay, so you see at level three, these are the level at which you are. These are the kind of entities you should be prepared to compute taxes for, right? And always these things, these computations will always come. It has 35 marks in your syllabus. Okay? These things have 35 marks in your syllabus, whether you like it or not. These 35 marks will always come. And now we've realized that the students are not so good at, I don't know, advanced tax students are not so good with computations. The same as principles of tax. Why? I think they do not get the principles very well. Okay, tax is something that you can't just use past questions to answer and go. No. You can solve past questions, but they can change the question. They can include any provision, and then you have a problem. Are we okay? So when it comes to corporate tax liabilities, this is the advanced level. But those are the principles of taxation level. Your focus is mostly on the mercantile or the merchandise type of company, right? The one who has sales, less cost of sales, gross profit, add other income, less expenses, get what? Profit before interest and tax, interest, profit before tax, tax, right? That's the kind of question. But at advanced level, it could be interest income, interest expense, commissions and fees income, commissions and fees expense, operating income, less expenses. It could be gross premium received, less reinsurance returns, less reinsurance premium, net premium income, reserve for unexpired risk, opening, closing. Then you add other expenses, take management fees, claims paid, claims received, all that, right? So it depends. It depends on what you are giving. But I'm just giving you the general overview that at your level, when we say company, we've defined company under the head. So you know, company extends beyond the normal company that you know. Now, when you visit section 101, subsection 4, it defines a resident company as a company which is incorporated under the Companies Act 2019 at 992, or a company whose management and control of its affairs is in Ghana. So when you are doing international taxation, we call that the place of effective management, right? Where your directors do their meetings, where you have your plans and your commercial decisions taken, right? So these things are quite broad. And even at the lower level, you have to understand these things. Okay, don't worry. We are there for you. Okay, who has any questions so far? Can we go back to the syllabus now? So that's about corporate tax and what you need to do. Now, we come to chargeable gains. Now, chargeable gains at the advanced level is very advanced, to the extent that we even go into changes in ownership. Okay, that is what we call realization. Realization simply means sale of assets and shares. Okay, yeah, Abdul Rafiq, your hand is up.
Yeah, please. I wanted to find out with regards to examining of the special areas. You made mention of gross premium received and all those things.
Yeah.
Would there be a situation where an insurance sort of person would come? Because I know
there could be. Okay. There could be. But you see, ICA has made it that those areas are specialized areas, which, though it's in the syllabus, they have never examined before. That doesn't mean it will never be examined, right? Because they have other areas which are more tax related. That's why they don't like asking these questions, right? But that doesn't mean you shouldn't know them, because now ICA is extending their hands. I get it. Yes. So just know them.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome, boss. So when it comes to chargeable gains, when we visit section 35, you see, I'm taking everything in a jiffy, right? When we visit section 35, we understand what chargeable gains involve. So everything, I'll just take you into the act, and then we are going to look at what it means when we talk about chargeable gains. So please, I hope you are writing something. Don't just sit down and relax, and be chewing gum. Somebody is chewing gum and just relaxing. No book in front of him. Please write something. It will help you. It will help you. Let's go to section 35. Section 35. Yeah. So, where is it? Uh-huh. Look, calculation of gains and losses. A gain made by a person from the realization, and I explained to you what realization means, right? Simply the sale. So before we've seen the word realization, before we can go further, let's go to section 38, okay? So section 38, realization. Now, at your level, realization would be, you let me just take A to C, right? I don't want to confuse people. So when we say somebody has realized an asset, A, if the person parts with the ownership of that asset, including when you sell the asset. So when I sell an asset, it has been deemed to be realized. When I exchange an asset with another one, it has been deemed to be realized. When I transfer an asset, it is realized. When I distribute an asset, it is realized. When I redeem a lost asset, it is realized. When I destroy an asset, it is realized. When an asset is lost, it is realized. When an asset expires, that means it has been consumed away by realization, by depreciation. It has been realized, or it is out of fashion. It has been realized. If it has been surrendered due to a court case or something, it is realized, right? I've given you all the different terms of realization. Now, in the case of an asset where the owner, the person who controls that asset, ceases to exist. If it's a company, that means the company has what? Has been liquidated, or it has gone bankrupt. If it is an individual, then he is dead. So if you have some properties and you die, immediately before you died or you cease, are you getting it, to exist, your assets have been deemed to be realized. Basic concept of realization. Please, have we understood realization? Now, if you have an asset,
can you go over again, sir?
Go over which one?
When a person seems to exist,
Yes,
that point.
To exist in simple terms, debt. How do companies die? Is it not through liquidation or bankruptcy?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So when the company ceases to exist, right? Immediately before you cease to exist, if an individual, immediately before you die, all the properties you administer have been deemed to be realized, right? If we go deeper into realization, it will be realized at its net cost. And I would maybe probably in class, but at this level, I don't want to go detailed into those things. But literally, you see, if we are going to sell properties that you owned already, right? By all means, we must incur some cost to repair and do some small things, right? When we take those things out, you've done it in financial reporting as what? Fair value, less cost to sell and cost to complete. How many of you have seen that before? Yes, something like that, right? So you have been deemed to realize your asset at the fair value, less cost to sell and cost to complete. Something like that. Is that okay? That's just the basics. I want you to get the idea. So we've seen realization from three areas. When you exchange your asset, the asset is sold and all that. In the case of an asset which is not trading stock, when we say trading stock, we mean your goods that you sell. When it is not goods or it's not a depreciable asset, then if the consideration received by that person from the sale exceeds the cost of the asset has been deemed to be realized. What does this mean? Let's take a simple example, right? So AB purchase, please write the example down. It works in every level. AB purchased land at Abokobi Nozu 12 years ago. So 12 years ago at a cost of, let's say, 120,000 or so. And in 2023, he sells the land for, let's say, 350,000, right? Then he incurred, let's say, 10,000 to build fence wall, 10,000 to build fence wall, 10%. Agent fees, or let me make it 5%. 5% to get an agent to sell for him. So he paid 5% agent fees and then 5,000 CDs for marketing, right? For marketing. Now, you see this one. We are saying that where the consideration, the sum of the consideration that you receive exceeds the cost of the asset. So if you are looking at it, somebody should just summarize the total cost this guy made. A cousin or boy, would he make a profit or would he make a loss? You see, in accounting, we do profit or loss on disposal. Tax, we do realization. So the accounting profit or loss that you guys learn, where we take the sale proceeds minus carrying amount, it does not work like that in tax. Tax has its own rules, which we call realization. And this thing is always examined at level three. But it's, we examine the company side of things, which we call changes in ownership under section 62. Okay? Are you getting something? Have you finished writing the question? Can we solve together? Can we solve together?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Have you finished writing the question? Yeah. So let's see. So when we look at the cost, right, the cost of an asset, we make reference to section 36, okay? Talks about cost. And in simple terms, anytime you are looking at cost, it is made up of three things. It's actually four, but the three is the most important. One is the initial cost. That is the cost of what? Acquisition, okay? The cost of acquisition of the asset or manufacturing, if you are the one who manufactured it, or production, are you getting it? That is, if you yourself, you made it. Now, two, we could have the cost of alteration also, whether you change the asset in some way, renovation, improvement, are you getting it? Repairs or maintenance on the asset before you used it. Then finally, you can talk about incidental expenses, okay? So incidental expenditure. When we talk about incidental expenditure, we mean other expenses that you incurred, including transfer taxes. So if you incurred some taxes that helped you to finally sell the asset, all these things are considered as part of cost. So anytime you hear cost in relation to a particular asset, which is not a depreciable asset, a depreciable asset is an asset which loses value, are you getting it? Because of the what wear and tear, deflation of time, or obsolescence, right? And does not include things like goodwill, an interest in land, or membership interest in an entity. So if you have any asset that can be depreciated, it does not fall, its cost does not go into this category. Okay. So in that case, we are saying that when we see cost, these are the three things that goes into cost. So with the information that I gave you, let's see if we can get cost for the item. You are going to give me the details of the cost. Let's see. So what is the cost? Let's see. Let's see. Was there cost of acquisition? Cost of acquisition? How much was that?
120,000.
For the last 420,000. Okay, nice. Was there any alteration or improvement cost?
Yes, that was land and fence, rather. Okay. 10,000.
Construction of fence. 10,000 or so. Then?
Yes.
Was there any incidental cost?
Yes, agency fee, 5%.
Okay, so agency fee. So before the agency, the agent will sell, you have to pay 5% of how much he sold it, right? He sold the land for 350,000 or so. So 5% of that.
15,000,
okay. Then we add marketing costs, right? Marketing fees, how much was that?
5,000,
okay. Was that all or there were other costs?
That's all.
Okay, so we add all this up. That gives us what? 30,000 or so. So that means the cost of the asset is what? 150,000 or so. So if we want realization to get our gain or loss on realization, okay, therefore we have what? Our consideration received. How much did we receive?
300,000.
350, right? We sold it for 350. Then we less what? The cost of the asset.
If it's 350, then the agency fee is supposed to be more than that. I took it to be 300.
Oh, it's 350. So that one will be how much? So let's change it as well. You let's take it to be 300, no problem. We are learning, so it doesn't matter. So no problem. I hope that's okay. So still well. So that means
we let's use the 350.
Let's just use it like that. It's the understanding. So I don't want to waste time. We have so many things to look at. So in that case, that means what's our gain on realization?
150,000.
Okay. So in actual sense, in Ghana, when you realize an asset, if you're a company, you just add to your income, right, for tax purposes. That means if I compute my tax, my income, I'll add it to it, and then I'll tax all together at 25%, or if I'm a mining company, 35% and the rest, right? But for individuals, there's an option, right? Individuals have an option. Before 2023 June, when the amendments came, individuals had the option to either add to income or tax separately at 15% when you visit the first schedule, paragraph 3 of the first schedule, right? But now you can either add to your income or tax it separately at 25%. Okay, so that is it. So this one, you can use it for tax planning. You can check and see if the individual's income is around 17.5. Then I'll prefer adding to his income. But if he's around the 35%, then I'll prefer taxing it separately at 25%. I hope that makes sense. Basically, that's realization. So this is what level 2, they focus mostly on. At level 3, realization is more about companies, okay, where we sell companies or we sell shares. Okay, so that one leads to something we call changes in ownership. Okay, changes in ownership, every diet is in level 3 paper. It will come. Every diet is there, hidden as part of one particular question. So what does that mean? Changes in ownership happens when a company changes by more than, okay, its underlying ownership changes by more than 50% within 3 years, or within the previous 3 years. What does this mean? Do you know that if a parent acquires a subsidiary, he should have more than 50% shares to have control? True or false?
Yes, true.
Now, true. What happens is that if I buy 50% of, let's say I bought 51% of your company, right? That means how much are you retaining in your old, in your company now? Is it not 49?
Yes.
So have you not lost the control you were initially having?
Dilution of control, yeah.
Yes, you have lost it because you've lost it to somebody. So if this is company A, let's see, this company A, right? Company A has its own 100% already. So finally, company A in 2015 decided to sell what? 10, let's say it sold 10% to company B. That means how much will company A be retaining? That means B has 10, right? That means company A now has 90% of the original company. True or false?
True.
Now let's go to 2016. Company A decided to sell what? An additional 20% to company B. That means B now has what? A will now have what left?
A will have 70.
70 left, right? But B is going to have what?
30.
30% now, okay. Now, let's go to 2017. A finally decided to sell, let's say, 35% to company C. Now, company C has 35. But what does A have now?
A has 35.
A has 35. Now, within the previous 3 years, has A lost more than 50% of its original value?
Yes.
Yes. So anytime this is seen to have happened, we say you have changed ownership. And anytime you change ownership, it's an anti-avoidance provision. The law stops people from doing this because you see these Lebanese companies and these Chinese companies, when they come, this is what they do. They intentionally go and buy other companies so that they can take advantage of losses and expenses, deduction, bad debts and other things. You get it? So the law says under Section 62 that anytime we see this thing happening, immediately before the change, so there are three conditions that the law gives out. And every diet is in your paper, whether you like it or not. One, immediately before the change, all assets and liabilities are deemed to be realized, right? Are deemed to be realized. Two, okay, so this is the first criteria. So if you see the guy's land that he had, even though maybe he hasn't sold it, but the market value was 350,000, okay, against all the costs he has incurred, immediately before this change happened, GRA will assume that the land has been sold and you pay tax on it. This is the first condition. Secondly, you cannot do some things, okay? You cannot deduct some expenses. You cannot deduct some expenses. And what are those expenses? One, you cannot carry forward any losses. You cannot carry forward losses. You cannot carry forward financial costs. Don't worry if you do not understand that. We will learn everything that you have to know. You cannot carry forward financial costs. Three, you cannot deduct or reverse bad debts. So Section 17, Section 16, deduct or reverse bad debts. That's Section 23. Then you cannot carry back long-term contract losses. Long-term contract losses. Section 24. Okay, so you cannot do these things. And the third is that immediately before the change, the period before the change and after the change shall be treated as two separate years of assessment. Okay, so if I ended this transaction on 31st January, right? So 31st, any period before 31st January and 1st February shall be treated as two separate years, and tax will be calculated for all those two separate years. So is this thing good or is bad? Would you want to change ownership or you wouldn't? Would you want to change ownership or you wouldn't? Would you want to change ownership or you wouldn't? Nobody's answering me. Because when you change ownership, all these things, all these consequences are going to be faced. So it is better you do not lose control within 3 years. Because if you do so, you are going to face the consequences, which is this. Now, every time, this thing is part of your questions that you get. Whether I like it or not, it will come. I won't lie to you. I've been doing this for a long time and I know what I'm talking about. Every day, it is hidden somewhere in your paper. At the level two, it's more practical. Level three is more practical, right? It will be hidden as part of a scenario where you have to guess. Somebody bought some 60% share somewhere. It tells you that then the original company has lost about 40%, has lost 60%, right? But at level two, it will just come. They will just ask you straightforward. Now, when you look in the level two syllabus, okay? I mean, we had the syllabus already. I just wanted to do an overview of most of the topics before we dive deeper, right? So chargeable gains goes with gift taxes. Now, in the Income Tax Act, it never mentioned anything about gift tax, like the way we used to tax gifts, right? But every law has transitional provisions. Even though the thing is not in the act, if you have any previous acts, you can base on that previous act to generate the value of that particular gift. Now, one thing you must understand here when it comes to gift tax is that in our new law, gift tax has been spread, unlike before when it was a separate tax. Now, when you have any gifts belonging to, employment income, it's an employment gift, add it to employment income. If you have any gifts belonging to business income, add it to business income. If you have any gifts belonging to investment income, add it to investment income, right? That's as simple as it goes. And gift taxes, where tax at 15% before, but now gift taxes are taxed at 25%. So that's everything you need to know about gift tax, right? They can give you computations, and gift tax, that gifts that are below 50 cedis are not taxable. So always when you compute gifts, exempt 50 cedis. Okay. Then when you come here, Social Security and Pension Funds, you know that there's a three-tier pension scheme. Are you getting it? Which you have to know the tier one, tier two, tier three. You must know the maximum contributions that go into it and the various what exemptions for tax purposes. However, it can go further, but I think that's what you need to know. Okay, so when we are looking at the contributions, let me just explain it in a jiffy for you. At level three, yes, you still need to know about them. So let's see. So let me say employer, then I give employee, right? When you are in an employment, these are the things you need to understand. So employer, employee, and then let's see the total. Let's see how it goes. Now, we operate a three-tier scheme as per the Act 766. That's the Pensions Act, okay? So three-tier scheme. So let's see. We have the tier one, okay? The tier one, which people normally know, it goes to SNITs, okay? So this tier one, the employer contributes 13%. The employee contributes 0.5%. Everything you are seeing here, I'm saying, is of the employee's basic salary. Okay, so that means you have 13.5%. Then you have the tier two, which goes to an approved fund manager, but still goes through SNIT, right? So we have the employer not contributing. Everything is contributed by the employee. 5%, right? So you have 5% here. So out of this 13.5, actually, 11% goes to SNIT, right? And then the 2.5 left goes to NHIL, National Health Insurance Levy. Okay, so that is it. So the tier one and the tier two are the mandatory contributions that if you do not pay, no, they have to force you to pay. It's required by law. Okay, so So we have the employee's total contribution being 5.5, and then overall 18.5 of your salary should have been contributed to Social Security. But there's a voluntary scheme, right? Which if you like, you can contribute. However, in some organizations, they require that you contribute to tier 3 compulsory. And tier 3, if you dive deeper into that 766, we have something we call personal pension schemes or personal pension schemes, right? Which are also like tier 3, where a group of people decide to contribute towards a staff saving scheme or something, right? The law also allows you a deduction for them. Now, to this extent, is the only one we give a tax deduction for, or we allow you to treat as a relief, okay? So tier 3, we have that one to go to approved fund managers, right? It depends. Employee can contribute some. You can also contribute some, but up to a maximum of 16.5%. Anything beyond 16.5% of your salary is taxable, because this is the only relief they've given you. Okay. So basically, this is a 3-tier pension scheme. And you should know when to file this, when to file reports. That's all.
Sir, please, sorry. You are talking about the 16.5 is on the basic.
Yes, everything is on the basic. So you can only do, however, there's a cap. There's a cap. I think they've increased it. It used to be 25,000. Now I think it's 40-something thousand. But it shouldn't exceed that amount, okay? So your 16.5 is the maximum that we can give you a relief for, right? When we say we can give you a relief for, it means you can treat as a deduction. So let's say if my salary is 20,000, 16.5 of it is the only one I can get a deduction for, a tax deduction. Anything beyond that is taxable. And this tier 3, there's no one way of contributing, right? The employer can decide to contribute 10% and you contribute a 6.5. The employer can decide to not contribute at all. You contribute your 16.5, or you can even contribute only 5%. It's up to you. This is the maximum. So anything before the maximum, nobody cares. You can contribute anything you want. It's up to you. But the thing is that if you withdraw from your provident fund, right, immediately before a specified period, you are going to be penalized. So you pay additional tax, okay? So withdrawal from the provident fund, if you're in the formal sector, before 10 years, are you getting it? Before 10 years, you pay tax of 15% on the withdrawal. If you are in the informal sector, before 5 years, you pay tax of 15% on the withdrawal. However, because of COVID-19, okay, you know, some people suffered employment issues and stuff. If you can prove to the commissioner that because of COVID you lost your job and other things, then you can withdraw from your provident fund without any penalty. Is that okay? I hope we've understood the 3-tier pension scheme in Ghana. Have we understood? Can we move?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so the next area of importance is VAT. However, VAT is in level 3, but it has never been examined. Right? It's part of corporate tax liabilities. They believe that they can give you the normal merchandise systems. But when it comes to VAT now, they've changed VAT. VAT in a summary is what? A tax on value added. People are like, this tax on value added, what does it mean? Let me explain to you why we call it value added tax. In Ghana, we use what we call the input credit system, right? Input credit system, meaning that whatever is, if I am registered for VAT, right? If I make 200,000 sales or more within a year, I can go and what? Register, right? Now, when you register for VAT, the benefit is that when you also buy something from a VAT registered person, you can deduct the VAT you pay to that person from your VAT that you make, right? So actually, we take the output tax, which is the VAT on sales, right? The VAT on sales. And then we less our deductible input taxes from it, right? Input tax, which is the accepted VAT on purchases, right? So yes, you can have VAT on purchases, but it's not all the VAT that is on your purchases that you can deduct. You get it? So this gives you your net tax payable or claimable, right? That's a refund. Sometimes your output, your input may be more than your output. So this is what we call the input credit system or the invoice credit system. Now, For instance, if I purchase some goods and I do not possess an invoice for it, then according to Section 48 of the VAT Act, I'm not going to be granted a deduction for that input. However, if I can prove to the commissioner that failure to get the invoice was not my fault, the tax I'm claiming is correct, and I pursue the person to no avail, he can allow me to deduct that input tax, right? So in Ghana now, we've inculcated the levies into the VAT, right? So now if I have an average sale, let's say if I have an average sale, let's say I made sales of like 100,000 CDs, right? How do we compute VAT on this? Actually, VAT is 15% on the taxable value, okay? So VAT is now 15% of taxable value. When we say taxable value, what is taxable value? Taxable value is actually equal to the exclusive amount. When we say exclusive, it means it does not have any tax plus the levies. So we have NHIL, 2.5% of the exclusive amount, get fund levy, 2.5%, and then we have COVID-19 health recovery levy, which is 1%, right? All on this exclusive figure before we find 15% of the taxable value. So using the same 100,000, we are going to take a simple illustration to understand how to compute VAT, right? And let me show you how the invoice credit system works. So we have a company, Nosu, which makes taxable supplies of, okay? The company makes taxable supplies of, let's say, 300,000, Nosu. Are we okay? So the company makes taxable supplies of 300,000. And then we have required one. We're going to compute the levies payable, okay? Levies payable. Then two, VAT payable. If, where's my calculator? Let me check something. Okay. If input taxes were equal to 15,700. Okay. Then three, withholding. Yeah, let me just ignore that. So this is what you have then, right? This is what we have. So with this, what we are saying is that, okay, now that we know this figure is the amount we have sold, we need to get how much we are actually going to pay. If I'm to teach you VAT accounting, then it will make more sense. But in simple terms, you are saying that, okay, so the sale which I made, which was VAT exclusive, I haven't taken any VAT, right? But I know what the customer will go and pay is 300,000 or so. But then I have to calculate NHIL of 2.5% on this 300,000. How much would that be?
7,500.
So that's 7,500, right? So we have get fund levy going for how much?
2.5.
The 300,000, the same 7,500, right?
Yes, please.
And we have COVID-19 health recovery levy.
1%.
1% on the 300,000, that's going to give us 2,000 or so. Now, when you add all this together, what do we get?
318,000.
So you get 318,000, right? So 318,000 becomes a taxable amount, okay, or taxable value. Then now we take our VAT, which is, because this is sales, this is our VAT on sales, which is our output tax. So we have what, 15% of the 318,000. And how much does that give us?
47,700.
So you get 47,700, okay? So now that you've seen this, you can literally get this person's net tax liability, okay? So net tax liability. So we have our output tax being how much? We've worked it out to be 47,700, not so. Then we less our deductible input tax, giving us what? 15,700, meaning the net tax to pay to GRE would be what? 30,000 Ghana cedis. Makes sense, right? This as simple as it is. But however, there are some complications. These deductible input tax, there are ones that we can deduct, ones we cannot deduct, right? Like entertainment expenses, subscriptions, vehicle businesses, which are not wholly exclusively and necessarily incurred. We have apportionment of deductible input tax and so many things. And even registration has the 200,000 threshold and exceptions regarding thresholds. Voluntary registration, registration for branches, subsidiaries, groups, and other stuff, right? Which you have to literally know if you are doing principles of taxation. At the advanced level, well, if they even bring VAT, it will not be that complex. Maybe somebody has failed to pay VAT. Let me give you a typical scenario which can come under advanced taxation. At your level, you are, it will be mixed as part of a normal question. Let me give you how it works, okay? Don't worry.
Hello, bro. I have a question.
Yes, boss.
Yeah, related to the VAT component you calculated, it was on a standard. So in case you have an input of 3%. A flat rate,
yes, you can claim it. So far as you are operating a standard rate. So let me show you. I don't think this is within the scope of what you are doing. But actually, when you are a wholesaler or a retailer, right? So far as your sale is not more than 500,000, then you still apply your 3%. Actually, how did the 3% come about? The 3% is because they thought that people in the informal sector, right, were mostly illiterate. Most of them have not gone to school. So they sat down and said, okay, then let's come up with a system which will help them do this overall. So they did it a marginal, they did a marginal computation and said, okay, so now what we do is that we know that the total output on a normal scale has a marginal tax rate of 17.5%, right? And then the VAT portion, so this one was rounded off to about 18%, right? Roughly. Then we gave them an initial VAT input of only the VAT because you cannot claim NHL. You get the idea. We cannot claim the NHL part. So the VAT input, which was the, you know, the VAT itself then, VAT was 15%, right? And NHL was how much? Is it not 2.5? Before, that was it, when they created this, the flat rate, right? So remember, we cannot claim the levy, only the 15%. So the 15% was set off against this, giving us 3%, which we apply. A lot of people do not know this. So this 3%, you know, it's a net of inputs, it's a net of output against input. So since this has already been done, now when you sell, you just apply the 3% on the sale. That's all. Meaning you have accounted for both the input and the output altogether. It's a marginal rating system. Okay. But now when COVID came, they've also, that means now when you sell, you also are going to apply 1% on the same sale. So that brings our flat rate to about 4% with COVID being 1%. But however, if you are a manufacturer, a service provider, and you buy from this person, because you're already doing the standard rate, the amount of tax you paid on this one can still be claimable. But however, the person who is the wholesaler or retailer, if he buys anything from anywhere, he cannot claim because he has already, it has already been factored into the computation of the 3%.
Yes, sir.
That's fine. So that's a little bit about VAT. However, within VAT, you still have communication service tax, right? So let's say if MTN sold some scratch cards to ANX Communications, right? So let's say this is it. And the amount he sold to him, let's say, was 500,000. Okay, 500,000. Let's see, this is tax inclusive. I'm just going to spice up things a little bit. You just exercise patience, right? Everything you need to know will be provided for you. Right? So if this is tax inclusive, it means that this thing has taxes inside. So you remember that we started putting some percentages down. So what I do is that I mostly like to get my VAT percentage before I start any question. Let's play a game. Now, if I'm using percentages, I know that the exclusive amount is always what? It's always 100%, right? You know that everything that you buy is always whole. True or false? True or false?
True.
Right? We know that on this figure, CST is always on the gross amount, right? So we take CST, communication service tax is now 5%, right? So we take 5% of the 100, which is literally 5, right? Then we have NHIL. They are all on the same exclusive figure. NHIL being what? 2.5. We have get fund levy being what? Being 2.5. You have COVID-19 health recovery levy being 1%, right? If you add all up, what percentage do you get?
What percent? 11%.
You get what? No, all to the
11.
You get 111%, right? Which
yes,
are taxable what? Value. Not so. Now let's calculate VAT. VAT to be what? That's 15% of the 111, leaving us with what? 15% of the 111 will be what? Because it's on this figure. Remember, VAT is always on taxable value. VAT to be what? Is it not 16.65?
Yes, sir.
If you add it, that means that the VAT inclusive amount, the amount that includes VAT percentage wise, is equivalent to 127. I said 127. Is it not 127? 127.65%. That means any amount which is inclusive is equivalent to 127.65. Based on this, you can get whatever missing figure you are looking for. Let's play the game and see. Let's see if based on the, how much scratch card did they sell? How much was the scratch card? 500,000, right? Which they said was VAT inclusive. So you are literally saying that, okay, the VAT inclusive percentage-wise, it was how much? It was 127.65%, right? And this was equivalent to 500,000 CDs. So what if I want the NHIL? I know NHIL is actually 2.5%, right? So what would that be? Would it be less or it would be more? Ratio?
Less.
Less. So if less?
Less.
If less?
Divide.
More divide.
More divide. As simple as
more
that.
More divide.
That is it. So in simple terms, we are saying that therefore an NHIL or get fund, which is still the same, will be 2.5 out of the 127.65 times the 500,000. And that gives us the NHIL component, which we are trying to find.
Right.
And that gives us what? 9792, right? 0.40. Okay, so that is them. Now, if I want COVID-19, what would that be? That would be 1 out of what? The same 127.65 times the 500,000. You get the idea. So let's see. What does that give us?
Yes.
That gives us 3916.96. Not so?
916.96.
If I want the exclusive value, the one without tax, we know that one is what? Go back to how you derived your figure, right? It was 100%. So I can go and do my 100 out of the 127.65 times the same 500,000. And that'll give me the gross amount. If I like, I can just get my gross amount. That's 100 out of 127.65 by the same 500,000. And that means I get a gross amount that I sold at 391,696.04. What if I want the CST? CST was 5%, not so. So I can do 5 out of what? The same 127.65 times the same 500,000. And I'm going to get a CST. Did you get 19,584.80? If I want VAT, the same thing. Very easy, right? Now, somebody said VAT is 15%. VAT is not 15% here. When you were generating your percentage, VAT was how much? 16.65. So you use the one you generated based on the marginal rate. So you are going to go here and say, okay, VAT is now what? 16.65. out of the 127.65, which will end up giving you 3 out of 23. So anytime VAT is inclusive, the VAT figure is always 3 out of 23 times the 500,000. And that's what will give you your output VAT, which is what? 3 out of 23 times 500,000. That means the VAT portion of this is 65,217.39. If you think it's not true, we can try and see if it works. See, let's take the original sale that we made. It was what? The exclusive value was actually worth 391,696, right? Let's take CST 5%. Do 5% of this and see what you get. You end up with 19,584.8. Do NHL 2.5 and see if you can still get the same thing, right? Get 9792.4. Okay. Get fund levy. The same thing, 9792.4. COVID-19. Get 3916. 3916.96. If you add all this, you get your taxable value. Yeah, 415,197.76. Now take your VAT at 15%. You get 62,279.664. I think there's been a miscalculation there, but literally you see the figures are all the same. That's how it works.
So, Prof, question. Why did you, the VAT, when you're trying to extract it, why did you divide by 16.65%?
You said, why did I?
You know, when you're trying to extract. Yeah, so you made it 16.65.
Yes, because that's what we got from our computation here. Remember, the taxable value ended at 111. And it's 15% of 111, leaving us with 16.65. percent of the taxable value. So if you want to use everything out of the 127.65, then you have to use the 16.6. However, it's ratio. So if you are very smart, you can use anything. For me, I don't mind. I can start from anywhere. So I can decide to use what? The taxable value. First, get the taxable value. Then I can deduct the levies from it. Then I get the VAT. So if I get this figure, and then I get the VAT portion, then whatever is left is the taxable value, which I can use to extract the levies. So it's up to you. But did you get the understanding?
Yes, please. I got a concept.
That is it. Okay, so we continue. So you see everything, I give you bits and pieces of it. Okay, so when it comes to natural resources, at level 2, you just have to know basics of natural resources. And level 2, basics of natural resources is all about natural resource payments, right? Just natural resource payments, 15% withholding tax, right? Or small scale mining, 3% withholding tax and those things. Just know the basis about withholding taxes, withholding for suppliers and the rest. Petroleum, you do not go into detail. But level 3, you need to know everything about petroleum and mining, right? The principles of taxation together with other stuff. So what do you need to know about at level 3? At level 3, we need to know, let me start with petroleum taxation. Okay, first of all, I'll start with what? One, the 3 types of petroleum operations in Ghana. Okay, so 3 types of petroleum operation, I call it PETOPs. We have 3 levels of petroleum operations or 3 sectors. So we have the upstream sector, which deals in the search for crude oil. We call that exploration. Then we come to what? After you explore or you search for crude oil, the next thing is you need to do what? Seismic surveys and geological, geophysical surveys to see if there's oil in commercial quantities in there, right? We call that the evaluation stage or analysis stage. If you are able to find oil, Then what you do is you start setting up machines. We call it the development stage, right? Then after that, you extract the oil. We call it the production stage. And that's the focus of your exam, because the other levels of petroleum, they apply taxes like any other company. Now, if these people extract the crude oil from the ground, right, they must, you know, we must refine it or change it into kerosene and petrol and other things. So what do? We send it to the midstream level. The midstream is the second sector or the second type of petroleum operation. Now, these people deal in only transport and refinery. So these people will transport the oil that these people produce, not so, and then refine it into something better. You get it? Then, apart from these people, a simple example is the Maya refinery and these transport, petroleum transport companies. At the upstream level, you can think about Technip GH. You can think about Cosmos. You've heard of Talo, not so. They are there, right? Then we have the downstream. Once these people have refined it, it has now become semi-finished or finished product. The downstream actually does the sales and marketing, right? That's why you guys hear OMC, oil marketing companies, right? Those guys, the Goyal and the Shell and the Total you've been buying fuel from, they are the downstream, right, sector. So you first have to understand the three types of petroleum operations, and these are the three types of petroleum operations. Does it make sense to you? Did it make sense to you?
Yes, please.
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay, so once you understood the three types of petroleum operation, the next thing you have to understand is the petroleum accounting types. Okay, so when it comes to petroleum accounting, petroleum doesn't follow our conventional accounting rules. Okay, they have their own accounting rules that they follow, but one is just like what you learn in class. Okay, one is just like what we know already. So we have what we call full cost accounting, which is the normal absorption, normal accounting that we know. And we have what we call successful effort accounting. Now, what does that mean? The difference between these two things is that it is how they treat expenses. When it comes to full costs, I'll just summarize it for you. Full cost, successful effort. Okay. So here, full cost, all capital expenditure. Okay, let's look at how we treat capital expenditure. All capital expenditure are capitalized. When we say capitalized, you understand, meaning it's put on the balance sheet, right? As usual, let's say you bought some machines, we all capitalize, you drilled well. Anything that is capital nature, we capitalize it. But when it comes to successful effort, we only capitalize if successful. What does that mean? Let's say we actually went to dig a well, right? We spent so much money in drilling. It's capital in nature. But if we met a dry well, meaning there was no oil inside, was it successful?
No.
No, it wasn't. That means that expense, will be what? Expensed. You get it? So far as it's not successful, it will be expensed. Only capitalized when successful. If not, expense. That's the rule under successful effort. But when it comes to revenue expenditure, meaning expenses which are general production, general and admin expenses, here we expense, here too we expense. That's the rule. So with successful effort, the only thing is that capital expenditure is only what capitalized when it's what? Successful, and expensed when it is not successful. So those are the two accounting types in petroleum. Then the third thing you have to know about petroleum taxation is the fiscal regime of oil and gas. When we say fiscal regime, this is simply how government enters into contracts with petroleum contractors, right? So it's also known as the contractual systems. Okay, so the contractual systems. So the contractual systems, okay, and we used to have two, but let me simplify it for you. So we can have one, what we call the production sharing agreement or production sharing contract, which is the oldest form of contracting system, which was used in Indonesia in 1966. Okay, the oldest system. Then the second one is what we call the licensing regime, or simply the royalty tax system. Royalty tax system. Then the third one is what we call a service contracts. Let me just use service contracts. Some people just use risk service. Then finally, we have a hybrid system, which is a combination of either of these systems. However, we could put joint venture in there somewhere because it's like a system of some sort. So we are saying that anytime anybody wants to come and drill oil in our country, what happens is that you can choose some systems. These are global systems. However, Ghana, that's why I've circled hybrid. Your examiner says we should use hybrid. That Ghana operates a hybrid system, and I'll explain to you. Now, the production sharing contract is like this. So this is the contractor, right? He comes to Ghana to drill the oil, come and look for oil. The government will give him the production rights and all that, right? So this guy goes, looks for the oils, bears all the risks, okay? Looks for oil, bears the risk. Okay, then do you know what happens? When he gets oil, okay, he will take part to cover cost, okay? So when he gets oil, he will take part of the oil to cover his cost because Waboka, we call that cost oil, okay? Then the remainder will be shared with the government, okay? We call that profit oil. So that's all about production sharing contract. Very easy, right? That is it. Any questions so far? Everybody's on point, right? So that's the production sharing contract. Now we go to the royalty tax system. Now with the royalty tax system, what happens is that the same thing happens. You give the person the room to go and look for oil and gas. He bears the risk himself. But here, only when the person gets oil is when he what? He pays taxes on income, okay, and royalties on production, okay? So this is it. But here, the oil you get all is for you. You can decide to export it, sell it, we don't care. But anytime you're exporting, you have to less domestic supply agreement, meaning that Ghana also needs oil for its system. So anytime you want to export, you must take a portion and give to Ghana or sell to Ghana itself, right? So that is it. The third system is what we call a service contract. This one, the government has the petroleum resources, but it doesn't have maybe the expertise to drill. So come and drill for a fee. Makes sense, right? Come and drill for a fee. Okay, so yeah, you come and do the petroleum work for a fee. So we pay you. It's a service that you are offering me. Maybe I have the machines, but I don't know how to drill. You come and do all that, I pay you a fee. We have two types here. We have what we call the pure service contract. Pure service contract means that here you just come and do it for a fee, no risk attached. Then we have risk service contract. Risk service contract means that you share the risk with the state. So shared economic risk with host government. So these are the petroleum systems. Now, the hybrid is a combination of either of these systems. So when it comes to the fiscal regime of Ghana, what system do we operate? Your examiner says use the hybrid system. Why? Because one, Ghana is a joint venture partner. So let me use GMPC. GMPC represents Ghana in petroleum operations. So GMPC is a joint venture partner in all petroleum operations. And two, Ghana also uses a royalty tax system. So you see, it's two systems, right? So it uses state participation, which is like joint venture. It's also a fiscal regime, state participation, and also the royalty tax system. So Ghana uses two systems in one. So examiner says Ghana operates a hybrid system. The next question that they usually ask here is the revenue types that we make from oil and gas, right? The revenue types. So actually the name there, I don't want to confuse you, we call them fiscal elements, because all this fiscal regime that we saw, there's ways government can make money or contractors can also make money there. So government usually makes money from royalties. Okay, and at this level, royalty is the same. It's always 5% on gross production or gross income if you are given. Most of the time, your questions are always like this. Okay, you just get 5% of gross income if it's mining, if it's petroleum. Then they make things like surface rentals. Sometimes when you rent the land for you, you have to pay some rent, okay? And the rent, it depends. You have 7 years to search for crude oil or to search for oil. The first 3 years, okay, you are going to search. We call it the first period or the exploration period, where you are going to pay $30 per square kilometers, right? Then you graduate to the next 2 years. If you do not find oil, we call it the first extension period, you're going to pay $50 per square kilometer. Then finally, the next 2 years, you are going to pay $75 per square kilometer as rental. Then the final stages, which is like your development and production, you're now going to pay $100 per square kilometer. Okay, so there are there plenty. There are so many ways government can make money through dividends, through taxes, corporate taxes, or let's say petroleum income tax, and the rest. So there are a lot of things you look at here. But the most common exam questions that you are going to get here are one, computation of tax liabilities, okay, where you are going to be giving some computations where you do capital allowance expenses and that. And the next type of question that they can ask you here is distribution of crude oil. So how do you share crude oil? So sharing crude oil is so simple. One, we take our gross production, then we less any royalties. Okay, so we take our gross production, we take out any royalties, we get our net production after royalty. So net production after royalty. So we take our net production after royalty, we distribute as follows. So distributed as follows. Because Ghana is a joint venture partner in all operations, we must share for Ghana as well. So first, we share for Ghana, which is GMPC, right? And GMPC will get it in the form of initial interest, additional participating interest, and then we come to the other partners, okay? So the joint venture partner, let's say partner A, we share for him. Partner B, we also share for him. Then when you finish, you would have distributed all the crude oil. Apart from this, all the principles of taxation for mining and petroleum are still examined. Okay, so that's the thing about natural resources. Then we come to tax planning. Tax planning at level one and level two, it's there, but it's part of the Ghana tax system. So basically, at level two, they are just going to ask you about what tax planning is, the variables of tax planning, tax avoidance, and tax evasion. Okay? These are the key areas that they are going to ask you. So tax planning is simply the arrangement of your financial activities in such a way that it avails you of all the benefits that the law can provide. Then when it comes to the variables of tax planning, these are the factors that make tax planning possible. Okay, so we have what we call the entity variable, meaning where should I put my business to make sure I pay the lower taxes? So in Ghana, for instance, if you're a manufacturing company, not so. Or if you're a company, you pay 25%. If you're a sole proprietor, depending on where you find yourself, if you're a partnership, all of them have their tax rules. So based on the kind of entity you set, the tax rules there can help you save taxes. We have what we call the location variable. Where should I locate my business? So when we talk about the variables, you say, Sister Kate, why elite? So it has elite. So we have the location variable. Where should I situate my business to make me pay less taxes? So location variable, we can have manufacturing companies. If you are located in Accra and Tema, pay the first schedule, paragraph 8. Where you are located in Accra and Tema, you pay 25%. If you are located in a regional capital, you pay 18.75%. If you are located elsewhere outside the regional capital, you pay 12.5%, right? Then we have activity variable. What kind of activity should I go in to minimize taxes? For instance, if I decide to go and operate a hotel, I pay tax at 22% instead of the normal 25%. You get the idea. If I want to go into a cattle farm for the first 10 years, I don't pay any tax. So it's because of the nature of my activity that is making me what pay lower taxes. Then we have time variable. Nobody knew the time the tax rules are going to change, right? Nobody knew some expenses were going to be canceled, new ones are going to come. It's basically based on the time value of money, right? Because of changes in time, can changes in time allow you to shift taxes into the future or take advantage of provisions now? That's the time variable. The entity variable, which I explained, earlier. So at your level, at level two, these are the things you just need to know the definitions of and some few examples. But at level three, you need to know all the components of these things, right? That's what we call tax incentives. You have to know all the incentives in the law, the ones that require permission, the ones that do not require permission. So things that require permission, like free zones, you need to apply before you can get the exemptions. Ghana Investment Promotion Center, right? Tax waiver by Parliament or Ministry of Finance, you need permission. One district, one factory, you need permission. COVID incentives, you need permission. But the ones that do not require permission, like the capital allowance, the deductions, if you find yourself in a concession, those ones, right? Then you should know tax avoidance, exploiting loopholes in the law or taking advantage of loopholes in the law and creating artificial transactions to buttress them. Then we have tax evasion, which is dodging tax using illegal ways, staying outside the registration system, using false and misleading statements, fighting with tax officers, doing fraud. Okay, so that is it. Then you look at how to do tax liability for groups. At level two, tax liability for groups is hidden in the changes in ownership. At level three, we have transfer pricing and other anti-avoidance provisions, right? It's very, very important. Then client communication, which is literally tax. Here you have to look at how to prepare communication, professional communication. When we say professional communication, what we actually mean is you need to know how to write a memo, you need to know how to write a report, you need to write a letter, you need to know how to write a brief or a briefing note, you need to know how to write an advice, you need to know how to write an outline, you need to know how to write a presentation, right? And so on and so forth.
Objection.
Yes, objections are part. Objections take part of these forms. So these are the professional communication. Then now you must know how these communications are communicated with clients and the tax authorities. Okay, so you are now going to look at what returns, assessments, audits, refunds, everything tax administration. So literally that was it. The whole syllabus. Now, if you go to the framework of the syllabus itself, let's go to advanced taxation. Let me explain something to you. But I hope what we've done so far was worth it. Did it open some things up for you?
Very much.
Okay, so let's see. I mean, I see the system there. Look at it. Look at the syllabus breakdown. Optimal tax outcomes. How many marks?
60.
60 marks. The tax plan and inquiry is 60 marks. Wow. 60 solid marks. Tax planning. Now, tax for single companies and groups, 30 marks. Then communication with tax authorities, 10 marks, making 100. Makes sense, right? So let's dive deeper and let's see what they want us to know. They said what? Compute and advise on opportunities for optimal tax outcomes for complex situations in a legitimate and ethical manner. We've seen this. Now, look at this. Look at so many things in there. We should look at types of investment and expenditures that will result in tax liabilities for individuals or businesses. So you just have to look at the types of investment. And investment could be investment in financial assets or physical assets, right? Remember, that's what we call investment. So a typical investment will be in buying assets at the end of the year to enjoy capital allowance, buying some assets. Are you getting that? May produce income, borrowing a loan to buy some assets so that the interest can be deductible, right? All these things are tax-favored investments. We have to look at legitimate tax planning measures, meaning tax avoidance measures, right? Because it's legitimate, which by way the tax liabilities arising from a particular situation, scenario, or course of action can be mitigated. You see, here everything is about tax planning. The appropriateness of such investment, expenditure, or measures given a particular taxpayer's circumstances, meaning they'll give you somebody's scenario or their stated objectives, meaning what they want to achieve. So a typical question will be, an investor from the UK wants to come and invest in manufacturing in Ghana. That means they've given you his stated objectives, and you are now going to say, okay, if you are going to manufacturing has these incentives, and these are the things you consider. I told you, Accra and Tema, you pay 25, elsewhere you pay 12.5, regional capital 18.75. However, you should consider the following factors: proximity of raw materials, proximity of labor, how close is it to your market, is there competition? You look at all these things before you situate your business elsewhere, right? Then we look at the mitigation of tax in the manner recommended. Yes, so if you've done all this, so you see the syllabus itself tells you how you should go about it. So the mitigation tells you how you should reduce the taxes, right? By reference to numerical analysis, if you can put in some numbers or some reasoned argument, that is fine, right? Once you know how to do these things, then you can now put it directly into the various tax incentives, including the Ghana Free Zones, investment promotion centers. Are you getting it? These things are conk. I always tell students, it will be your own doom if you do not learn about Ghana Investment Promotion Center and free zones, because most of the time, these things, we are not going to worry ourselves to teach in class, because it's a sure banker. Just go and know the rules there. You are good to go. Why would you go and sit advanced taxation paper and you don't know free zones and Ghana Investment Promotion Center? It is your own doom, right? And the influence and their influence on business setup options, approaches to availing business of tax incentives. So basically, when it comes to free zones, they are going to give you some questions. They are going to ask you some questions on it. And then what are you going to do about that? Let's see if I can get a simple question. I like to be very practical, give you practical scenarios so that you appreciate what we are doing, right? So this is a syllabus walkthrough, but I'm actually teaching you. So let's see if I can get something on free zones, free zones, free zones, free zones, okay? So there's the advanced taxation textbook. Let's see if we can. Reasons, best reasons, because tax incentives and money. Why have I gone to 213? 21. The tax incentives. See. Free zone enclave. Okay, so these free zones, right? So you see, you have to know all these things: the free zone board, the functions of the board, qualification of free zone developers, the rights of free zone developers. You have to know all these things. Then the incentives are what they are concerned about. Most of the time at your level, they are just going to ask you about the various incentives, right? They are exempt from income tax for the first 10 years. After the 10 years, if they're in exports, they'll pay 15%. Shareholders are exempt for withholding taxes. They are not, import laws do not apply to them, and so on and so forth, right? They are there plenty. Okay, so when you know these incentives, you should be fine. You should be definitely fine. So I'm just looking for a question on free zones. I just want to show you something. Oh, where am I going? How the questions do come. Who has any question for me? So one question like that. Mm-hmm. So let me just start from here. In the question and answer bank. So see, just going to show you that everything, there's proof, right? So see. So you see, this is from strategic tax planning from CIT. You see, conditions for registration as a free zone entity, 5 incentives available to investors who establish free zone entities, 20 marks. Now let's go to ICA. Let's see. November 2021, question 1. Estana, a Ghanaian by birth, has spent most of her life in the UK. She has made a lot of savings and would want to invest in Ghana. She has heard of Ghana Free Zone Authority and has been told that the rationale behind the free trade zone is the development of disadvantaged regions. You work in a tax consulting firm, and your managing partner has called on you to brief Esther on the following issues during her next appointment to the tax consulting firm. So draft a report that will incorporate the following: the tax incentives and benefits for free zone enterprise. What will be the tax implication if the free zone enterprise sells into the local market? What are the requirements of a foreigner should meet to start trading in Ghana? So you see, typical question. You have to know this. 10, 4, 6, 20 only came on free zones. So people who hadn't read free zones that night, it was a big headache for them. So literally, that is it. So, see, another typical question. The Ghana Investment Promotion Center, it says three objectives of the GIPC. You see? Just like that, three marks. Now, see a question like this where you have to apply your knowledge, right? So the following is an extract of the financial statements of the following two companies. We have Tika and Taka. Tika is a free zone company resident in Ghana, and Taka is also a company resident in Ghana, and both companies are engaged in the sale of tiles. A Ghanaian who was living in the United States for a very long time has relocated to Ghana. You see, has relocated to Ghana and has sought your opinion. So they've given you somebody's case, which we read from the syllabus, and as a student of taxation, to advise on the company to buy shares in. The background checks indicate that the two companies have huge prospects. Which of the companies would you advise a Ghanaian to invest in and why? So since we know one is a free zone company, it's better than the other. You have to communicate, tell us. Now, you always have to adopt some sort of professional communication. Very, very important if you want to make the best out of the paper. Okay, so that was it. Then we must understand current issues in international taxation, including double taxation agreements and treaties and general anti-avoidance rules and anti-avoidance provisions, such as transfer pricing, then capitalization and income splitting. This thing is the major theme of your paper. If you do not know this, do not sit the paper, because all the questions that will even come, these things are mixed as part of it. I say we have mixed the garnishing with the things, right? I've mixed them up, so it will always come. But especially international taxation, we need to understand what we mean by double taxation, right? Before we know. So when we say double taxation, where you end up paying tax twice, right? Either in the same state or on the same income twice. So double taxation is of two forms. We have what we call juridical double taxation, and we have what we call economic double taxation. Let me explain to you using an example, right? So this is Kofi. Kofi goes to the UK. He makes some money in the UK. Okay, Kofi will bring that same money to Ghana. Now, in the UK, they will tax him, right? Because he made the money in the UK. In Ghana, too, he's a resident. A resident are taxed on worldwide income. They'll tax him in Ghana as well, resulting in double taxation. But what happens is that two different jurisdictions are taxing the same person. So jurisdiction, juridical, right? So juridical means two separate countries are taxing you on the same income. So the same person taxed twice. Economic is when one income is taxed twice in the hands of two separate taxpayers. Let's take a company. Simple, right? So company, when they make profit, 100, this profit will be taxed at 25%, right? 25. Now, assuming I send all these profits to my shareholders, right, as dividends, remember the dividends will also be taxed at 8%. So you see the same corporate profit has been taxed in the hands of two separate taxpayers, right? One as corporate profit, 25%, and one as dividend, not so 8%. So this is economic double taxation, and this is double taxation, juridical double taxation, right? So the whole thing is that we must find a way to reduce this juridical double taxation. That is where we enter into DTAs with other countries. So DTAs are just bilateral agreements that two countries enter into it to sort of what? Reduce people's what? Liability or alleviate or reduce double taxation. You get the idea. So that is it. So this double taxation, Ghana has double taxation with some countries, and some too we are negotiating, some too we are finally finalized them. So the common ones which have been concluded already, I use fine bags plus MMCS, right? Fine bags plus MMCS. So what is fine bags plus MMCS? We have France, Italy, Netherlands, Denmark, Belgium, UK, Germany, South Africa, Switzerland, Morocco, Mauritius, Czech Republic, Singapore. Okay, so basically this is double taxation DTAs, and you have to know some few things, benefits of DTAs, why we enter into DTAs, some key provisions in the DTAs, then you should be fine. It's not anything difficult. It says that students should learn. They are not learning enough. That's the thing. Then, apart from that, you must know transfer pricing, right? Which comes from the application of the arm's length standard. The whole thing is that when you visit section 26, it says we should quantify items in line with market value. So we have the act here. We can refer and see what I'm talking about. So let's go to section 31. Section 31. Look at what it says. It says what? Arm's length arrangement between associates. Where an arrangement exists between persons who are in a controlled relationship, the person shall calculate their income and tax payable according to the arm's length standard. When we say persons in controlled relationship, we mean related parties. And when you visit section 128, it tells us that a relationship between a person and a relative, so far as they do not act to the intentions of each other, they are related parties. Okay? So far as they act to the intentions of each other, they are related parties. Two, partners in a partnership. Anybody who is related that when they deal in transactions, they are not going to be fair to each other, are related parties. A group company and its subsidiaries, a person and an agent, a principal and agent, a permanent, a branch and its head office or headquarters, they are all related parties. When they are dealing with transactions, they should accord it with the arm's length standard. Arm's length standard means use the open market values on the market, right? So if I'm selling a car to my mother and I'll sell it at 270,000 and I'll sell to an outsider at 300,000, I have not been fair. It means that the price I gave my mother is not at arm's length. It's just like fair value, according to IFRS 13 also. Before 2013, it says what? Fair value is the price at which an asset will be exchanged or a liability settled with between willing and knowledgeable parties, not so, in an arm's length transaction, meaning you do not know me, I do not know you, we do it as if the open market value. After 2013, the amendment or the new exposure draft brought a new definition, which said what? Fair value is the price at which what? An asset will be exchanged or a liability settled between market participants at a measurement date in an orderly transaction, meaning it should not be a forced sale, right? So we are saying that the arm's length standard actually requires persons who are in a controlled relationship to quantify, characterize, apportion, and allocate amounts to be included in or deducted from income to reflect an arrangement that would have been made between independent persons. You get it? So act as if you didn't know each other. Now, the minister makes some regulations relating to transfer pricing because that's what people usually manipulate this arm's length standard to achieve. So you look at the LI, Legislative Instrument 241 to 412, right? That's what the minister made. So we will dive deep in class. We'll dive deep into this transfer pricing regulation to know. But anytime you fail to comply with the arm's length standard, the commissioner may what adjust your income to reflect the arm's length standard. So let's see. If company A, look, company A sells bicycles, it sells bicycles at 12,000 cedis to company B, right? But then we have an independent party which sells the same type of bicycles with the same functions, features, and everything to another third party on the market and sells these bicycles for 15,000. So far as all your activities are the same, the commissioner is going to say you haven't been fair. Your bicycles are supposed to be sold at 15, but you sold it to your brother at 12. So he will pass an extra 3,000 as an arm's length adjustment or transfer pricing adjustment to your profits, right? So this is the arm's length adjustment we are talking about. Literally, this is all about what you need to know here, but definitely it goes deeper into transfer pricing. So that is it. Then we look at tax implication of mergers, amalgamation, and reorganization, as well as changes in ownership arrangement. When we started, I talked about changes in ownership. It's part of it, right? Then we have to look at how to deal with branches, offices, and external companies. That's what we call permanent establishment. Every diet is there. You see, these things are something you have to know. Then we have to look at what? Tax position of overseas companies who are coming to establish fiscal position. So the whole thing is, we have what we call trading in Ghana and trading with Ghana. If you are trading in Ghana, it means you are in Ghana. That it connotes physical presence, right? So if you are trading in Ghana, you have physical presence here and you are subject to the laws. If you are an individual, that means the income you have accrued in Ghana or was what? Derived from Ghana. If you are a company, that means that the income, you have a place of control, a place of management or a place of business, right? That tells you are in Ghana. So you pay taxes within Ghana. You are mostly considered to be a permanent establishment. But however, if you are trading in Ghana, it means that you have some connection to Ghana, but you haven't made your income here. Somebody who comes to tour in Ghana with his own money from his country is seen to be trading with Ghana because he didn't make that money here. So that is it. If I buy goods in Ali Baba, there's no connection with Ghana. We are trading with Ghana, not in Ghana. Makes sense. So literally, that's the first part. The second part of your syllabus talks about what? Computing and advising on tax liabilities, including mining and mineral, petroleum operations, trust and exempt organizations. We talk We talked about this earlier on. Do you remember? Paying attention to the following. So you must identify opportunities for optimal tax outcomes in legitimate and ethical manner. You see, so for everything you see is legitimate and ethical, legitimate and ethical. So you have to know ethics. Whether you're in level two or level one, level two or level three, you must know the ethical principles, right? And see whether it has been breached in every scenario you are giving. So Pico, right? Remember, anytime, remember Dr. Pico, okay? So Pico, you must know about professional word, behavior, integrity, confidentiality, competence and due care, and objectivity, right? You must know this and know the breaches, right? You must know the breaches. Or simply the threats to ethical behavior, right? Management threats, where you're a tax officer and you are seen to be giving strategy to the client. It's not good. It's a threat. Advocacy threats, where you are supporting the client. Self-interest, where some because of some financial interest or something, you are not being fair. Maybe the client is giving you a bonus or some money. So you saw that he has made a mistake and you kept quiet. Self-review threats. This one mostly it will happen for tax auditors, right? Or somebody who prepared the account is the same person preparing the tax returns. He may not see the mistake he made, right? Intimidation, where they are giving you undue pressure or they are threatening you or something. Their familiarity, long association with that person, so you didn't see the mistakes he's making. Okay, these are the same things that can be mixed up with some questions. Then the use of exemptions and reliefs in deferring, meaning shifting taxes into the future or minimizing tax liabilities. Okay, so here, anything from individual to companies, they can ask you taxes on them, right? And that's what has been coming almost every day. Then prepare appropriate communications with clients and tax authorities and interpretation of tax statutes. So you see here, it talks about preparation of appropriate communication, which I explained. It could be letters, memos, it could be briefing notes, outline, presentation, advice, reports. I get to it. But mostly I see we prefer the memo form of report. So with clients and tax authorities and interpretation of tax statutes, paying attention to the following. Okay, so we have client instructions. Client may give you some instruction, preparing advice, which is appropriate, technically correct, and within the law and in accordance with ethical principles, right? You see the ethics is here again. Application of appropriate technical knowledge to support reasoned tax conclusions, okay? So these ones are part of the advisory. Then appropriate forms of communication. I told you letters, memoranda, all that. Communicating clearly in an appropriate manner to a specialist, which may be a tax consultant or a non-specialist client who doesn't know anything about tax. Identifying. So, any questions so far? I think that brings us to the end of our session. Did you learn anything new? Is there anything you want to tell me? Ask me.
Yes, your briefing is really good. Thank you very much.
You're welcome, boss.
And I'm currently in part. I just got to part. I just listened to it. So it's a whole new thing to me. So I really appreciate
that's fine.
Your enlightenment about the whole thing. Really appreciate. God bless you.
Amen. Amen. Any other? Yes, Abdul.
Yeah. Thank you very much for walking us through the process. As you made mention earlier, you said it's a walk through through the syllabus, but some of the items you ended up going in, deeper into those issues. So we really appreciate and we thank you so much for that. What I want to ask is that with regards to the exams,
yes,
would you advise that we actually take the past questions and study alongside with the text, or we have to go through the text first and then
do it together? That's the best
option. Okay. Okay.
Yes.